Hello there, friends. It's your boy here with another episode of All the Mods. And guess what? We're going to be working on our canola farm this episode. I bet you didn't see that one coming. We've only worked on this like every episode since we built it. But Actually Editions updated and gave us new ways to put this canola farm sort of on steroids. So that's what we're going to do this episode. This thing is still working fine ever since we fixed it up. Growing standing stones are now working, and in here everything is good. We're probably going to add some more machines later on in the episode, but for now most of our work is going to be done in this little cave here. Was that too subtle? I don't know. So the way we're actually going to beef up this canola farm is through some new types of oil. So we're going to need some canola seeds, which I've been stocking up a bit on. And we're also going to need a bucket of oil. So if we throw seeds onto the atomic reconstructor, we can now get crystallized canola seeds. And if we place down our bucket in the world, and then throw in a crystallized canola seed, we get crystallized canola oil. Now this stuff will give us 120 RF per tick as opposed to the 70 RF per tick we're getting with just this regular oil, but we can go one step further with this. If we come to our empower, we can place down a crystallized canola seed in the middle and then regular on the sides, and then that should do its thing. And you saw there were no particle effects, I actually changed the config. If you go to the Actually Editions config, then it's under performance, you can turn on less particles. I turned that to true because I'm tired of this empower dropping my frame rate. But anyways, now we do the same process, place down the oil, the crystallized oil, throw in an empowered canola seed, and then we get empowered oil. So this stuff will give us 200 RF per tick, so we're almost tripling the amount of RF we're getting at no real extra cost. So that's why we're gonna be doing this, it's super sick. But of course that whole process is going to be automated, which is where things get a little bit interesting. So the first thing I want to do is automate turning regular canola seeds into crystallized canola seeds. And of course we are going to need to craft some things for that, so we're going to make an automatic precision dropper, an atomic reconstructor, we're going to need to make some void crystal so we can get a ranged collector, and I think that's just about all we will need. So I'm going to go ahead and place the atomic reconstructor and stuff inside the wall here so I can kind of separate it and I won't pick up any of the seeds whenever they're sitting on the ground. So we will place down the atomic reconstructor as well as the automatic precision dropper. And I did forget to grab the power cell I needed for this atomic reconstructor, but we'll place that down and link that up so that should start filling up perfect. And both of these are on deactivation mode, so if we flip lever on there, it'll stop all of that firing and whatnot. And I just moved the one forward, I realized I moved it way too far back, but this is pretty much the extent of the automation we have to do for this. So if we just flip this lever after we put some seeds in there, you can see they're getting dropped, and every once in a while this atomic reconstructor is reconstructing them. So that's pretty easy, actually. The thing we actually have to do now is to pick these items up, so we're going to use the ranged collector for that. And we are going to place this kind of far back because we don't want this interfering with anything else we have to drop these crystallized canola seeds for. So if we whitelist crystallized canola seeds and we flip this lever, whenever these get reconstructed, they're going to get automatically picked up by that ranged collector. And then they'll end up in this internal inventory here, so we do have to pipe that right out. And we will pipe that out into this drawer here. So now all we have to do is put seeds in, flip the lever, those will get transformed, and then put right into this barrel. After we set this to extract, always active, of course. Now it'll start extracting in there, perfect. So that was pretty easy. The thing we have to worry about now is getting items into this precision dropper here. And I think we're going to do that using some modular storage. Now, I'm going to use modular storage not because I think it's necessarily the most necessary or the best way to maybe do this, but it'll be good in the future. I think the system I'm going to set up will be very useful for us later on. So we're going to go ahead and reinsert this tier 3 module I have sitting around. And this is ID1, so we'll link these two remote modules onto ID1. And then we're going to make an ESD from Actually Editions, which is going to kind of be the heart of this whole system. So if we come over into our little canola house, we can kind of see the setup I got going now. So I changed this up to drawers, as you kind of saw before, and back behind here we have a laser going into this chest, and that's the same laser that gets fed from our planter over there. It goes in the chest, which goes into the drawer controller. So we're going to place down an ESD right next to this canola seed drawer, and an ESD is essentially just a way to transport items from one inventory to another. So let's place down a modular storage and put that link ID in there. And nothing's going to happen, and that's because we have to actually specify the input and output sides for the ESD, and it looks like a bit of canola got in there. So the input and output is based on direction, so if you bring up our F3 menu, you can see we're facing to the east, So for our output side, we want to set this to East, and then some numbers are going to pop up here, and these numbers represent the slots that the ESD will insert into. So right now it's going to insert into slot 0 to 303, which is essentially just every slot that this modular storage has. And the thing about a modular storage is that it actually functions very much like a chest. The only difference between a modular storage and a chest is the way it displays its information, like in a list. But in a chest, the slots are labeled from 0 to 26, I believe, 0 being the top left, and then it goes in order. And so we can specify which of these slots it's going to input into. So for these canola seeds, we're going to input into slot 1 to 2. But this specification is exclusive, meaning that it's not going to input into the slot in the upper range. So it's not actually going to insert into slot 2, it'll only insert into slot 1. And it'll keep inserting into there until this slot gets full. Then it can't insert anything else, so it'll just stop. So if we set from 1 to 2, we just lock that in. We can set the inbound side, I happen to know, is south. In our modular storage, we now have a stack of canola seeds. And this is really great because we don't have to fill up this whole modular storage with 300 stacks of canola seeds. It'll always keep this stocked with a stack of canola seeds exactly. And that means we can put multiple items within this one storage module, as long as we hook up more ESDs with different slot numbers. And as I said, this is going to be really useful later on, maybe not so useful just for moving items this far. We definitely could use some laser relays or something like that, but oh well. Let's put in that remote module there, and then we will see our seeds. And then all we have to do is just hook up some conduits to this precision dropper, and then we're going to want to filter this to only insert regular canola seeds so it doesn't get anything wonky in there. So if we set this to always active, this should now start filling up with canola seeds, which is perfect. So now we can flip this lever. This modular storage will always stay stocked with a stack of canola seeds and keep this stocked. And then the canola seeds will just get turned into crystallized canola seeds and get put right into our storage drawer. And the ESD actually moves items at an alarmingly fast rate, moves stacks at a time stupidly quickly. So this is always going to stay stocked no matter what, as long as we have seeds coming in, which is the main concern. We don't really have enough canola to be getting that many seeds, but hopefully we can expand this later. So that is that pretty much done, but now that this is automated, this kind of creates a bit of a problem. Once this storage drawer gets full, we don't want these seeds to keep dropping and keep getting transformed, because that's a waste of seeds and that's a waste of RF. So we're going to add a bit of a safeguard in to detect whenever this storage drawer is full and shut off these machines so it won't drop or shoot lasers anymore. And so we're going to place a redstone comparator running out of this ranged collector. And to do this, we're also going to need an analog emitter from random things. So the analog emitter, as long as the side with the circle, which is the input side, is powered, so if we just place a torch there, we can specify what signal strength we want to get output from this analog emitter. So I want a signal strength of 5 coming out of there. So if we place down a redstone comparator and then place down some redstone, this redstone will be power level 5. So then, if we set this to subtraction mode, and we place another comparator down, if we input a signal strength that is greater than 5, what this analog emitter is emitting, such as 15, this is going to turn off, because it's doing 5 minus 15, which is a negative number, so it's just going to say 0. Now, this is useful because the ranged collector, when it's full, will output a signal strength of 5. So if we set down the analog emitter, we can place a torch that will lead into this block, which will deactivate both of these blocks whenever it turns on. So as I said, whenever the range collector is completely full, it's going to output a signal strength of 5. And so then it's going to do 5 minus 5 coming from the range collector, which will equal 0, which will turn this torch on and deactivate these two. But at any point when it's not full, this signal strength is going to be less than 5, meaning this torch will be off, allowing these to actually drop. And this range collector will only get full whenever it can't insert any more into the storage drawer. And we're doing it like that instead of putting a redstone upgrade on the storage drawer, because the redstone upgrades are a bit wonky. They don't seem to update correctly, so this works a bit better. So now if we flip this lever, this is going to just transform canola seeds until this drawer fills up and the internal buffer of the range collector fills up. And once that happens, it will stop. And I hate picking these stupid seeds up.
Perfect.
So now that that is working fine and dandy, let's get to automating the oil into crystallized oil. So we're gonna make an auto placer that we're gonna turn into a fluid placer. And then we're gonna make an auto breaker that is going to get made into a fluid collector. We're gonna need another automatic precision dropper. And I believe that's all the mod items we're gonna need, hopefully. No, I was just kidding. We're actually gonna need a liquid monitor from RF Tools. So we're gonna do the liquid transformation inside of this wall of the cave, and it's gonna take up a bit of room, so we're gonna have to do some terraforming afterwards, but that's okay. So let's place down our fluid placer and collector, and those two aren't too hard to figure out what they do. Let's place down an automatic precision dropper. So how this is gonna work is we're gonna set all these on pulse mode, and we're gonna activate both the dropper and fluid placer at the same time. And then that is going to make crystallized oil. And then one tick later, we'll activate the fluid collector, which is then just going to pick up that newly crystallized oil. But of course, I love my little safeguard, so we're gonna put a bit of a safeguard or just condition on this. So I only want the fluid to be placed and collected whenever there are actually items in this precision dropper. Any other time, the oil wouldn't get transformed, so there wouldn't be any point in placing down any oil, and honestly, it would just break the system. So we're gonna put a comparator coming out of this precision dropper, and then we're gonna make a comparator clock. And now that the rain is gone, we can work in peace. We're just going to lead this wire straight into these two machines here. So we'll place a block and then just run redstone on top of those. And then to complete the comparator clock, we're going to have to run the signal back into the side of this. So we'll place a block there. And then we're gonna use an upside down half slab to put a repeater on. And it's important we use an upside down half slab so we can, for one, bring this signal down into this comparator. And more importantly, or equally as importantly, we can bring this signal down into the fluid placer, which is right where that redstone is leading. So we set this to subtraction, and that is a working comparator clock. So if we put items in here, this will start pulsing, the signal is going to come around, and once it gets back over here, this level 15 is going to subtract from whatever signal is here, and so it'll always turn to zero, turning this off, and then it'll turn back on and so forth. And you can see the items just getting dropped right in there. So the fluid collector is only one tick delay we need it, and these two are getting activated at the same time. And as you can see, now that the cobblestone has all run out, this comparator clock turned off. So no longer will any fluid get placed or collected, which is absolutely perfect. Well, it's almost absolutely perfect. Obviously, if we put items in here, they're gonna drop no matter what. But if there's no fluid inside of this fluid placer, we also don't want the items to drop, because then we'd be placing fluid down for no reason. It would go everywhere. It'd be a big oil mess. So we are going to put in another little condition here with this liquid monitor. So let's run a couple redstone out of there. And the liquid monitor is going to output a redstone signal as long as the liquid inventory that we specify meets the parameters we set. So I'm gonna set this to monitor the fluid placer, and it'll give off a redstone signal whenever there is more than 20% fluid within this fluid placer. So that's like two or three buckets. I think it's right in between two and three. So once three buckets get in here, the liquid monitor will turn on, and then we're gonna run that into a piston that will be right here. And that'll make it so whenever this piston is retracted, meaning there is not enough fluid in our fluid placer, this will incomplete this comparator clock and nothing will happen, even if there are items in the dropper. So you can see if you put items in there, nothing will happen. But let's actually put some canola seeds in there, and then we'll go ahead and place some oil in there. And so it's gonna work on the third bucket, or the second bucket of oil. Okay, I thought it was three, it was obviously two. But as you saw, the liquid monitor turned on, it sort of flashed blue, which extended the piston back there, allowed the comparator clock to run, and then very quickly, you probably didn't actually see it change, but it very quickly turned that oil into crystallized oil, which then got collected. So that's pretty good. All we need to do now is hook up a wire to supply this precision dropper with these crystallized canola seeds. So we're gonna set this to extract on the brown channel, and we'll set that to always active. And then we will run our cable up here, and we will run it into this dropper, and we'll say insert only on the brown channel. So this will get supplied with crystallized canola seeds from this barrel. So that's one step closer, but we also have to supply this fluid placer with oil to meet our other parameter for this thing actually working. So to do that, we're gonna use some fluid laser relays here. So we'll grab three of those. Now the fluid laser relays work very similarly to the other laser relays, like the item laser relay, etc. Except as the name would suggest, it's going to transfer fluids from one inventory to the other instead of items or energy or whatever else. So we're gonna have to use multiple of these because they do have a 15 block range. So we'll place one down there, and then we'll place the other one back behind this wall here. And now that that is hooked up, we'll place down a conduit, and that'll already start doing its thing. And you can see stuff is happening now. This fluid placer is gonna fill up, and of course, yeah, that's gonna happen. Should have seen that one coming. All right, we got a little bit of a malfunction here. I don't know why I didn't expect this. Okay. All right, so what happened there, this fluid collector actually got filled up. So once it gets filled up, it's actually not going to be able to collect any more fluids. So we need to go ahead and extract from there and insert into this drum. So now that this fluid collector is staying empty, we can turn this thing back on. But of course, that is another little safeguard we need to implement. Now that we know that can go wrong, let's actually protect against this fluid collector getting filled up and not being able to actually collect the fluid and that spilling everywhere like it just did. So I've just made another liquid monitor, and we're gonna come down underneath this little thing here. So these liquid monitors actually do work out of range, so they don't have to be directly adjacent to whatever we're trying to monitor. So I'm gonna monitor that drum I just placed down, but it's not directly adjacent to it. And we're going to set it to monitor the iron drum, and we will set this to only turn on whenever the drum is less than 90%. And 90% of that drum is about 230,000 millibuckets, so that's quite a bit of oil we have in there, but when it's less than 90%, we want this to be on, so it should be on right now, yep. Then we're gonna lead that into a sticky piston, then the sticky piston is gonna have a block in front of it, and right there is our other liquid monitor, if you can sort of see it. So this is going to block off this signal from the liquid monitor and incomplete this circuit whenever that drum gets over 90% full, because if that drum gets completely full, that fluid collector is going to also get full and not be able to collect any fluids. So we want to make sure there's always room in this drum for this fluid collector to dump into. So now if we go back and we place this block back, this should start doing its thing again, okay? And this should be filling up, as you can see. And so after 90%, that piston will retract, incompleting the circuit. So even though there's liquids in here and there are items in here, it's still not going to drop anything. So that is pretty much flawless there. Any of the things that could go wrong are pretty much protected against. So actually that is those two systems pretty much done. We have completely automated crystallized canola oil here, which is awesome. But now that that's done, we need to go to the next stage of oil processing, which is gonna be empowered oil. And I'm gonna wanna do that up inside of this windmill here. It's super ugly in here, so I'm gonna have to pretty this up. But yeah, it's been sitting here for so long, I thought we may as well use it. And this little windmill place is actually like the perfect size for the empower. So I think I'm actually just gonna be lazy and snag the empower that's over here because I don't feel like making another one right now. So we can come in and set down all of the blocks we need to. Perfect. So now we gotta set up the conduits, but this is set up almost perfectly. So the power cell and this conduit are like right next to each other. So now that all the cables are actually hooked up, we're going to configure the item inputs. So I want this one to insert on the brown. And this drawer right here with crystallized canola seeds is set up to extract on the brown. So now if we go up, there should be a canola seed in there, hopefully. Yep, a crystallized canola seed is in there. And then on the display stands, we are going to set it up so it inserts on the green, but it will only insert regular canola seeds. And a quick tip, if you actually take these item filters and then you craft them together with blank item filters, then they will copy the settings. So now all these item filters are set up to only insert regular canola seeds. So I set them all up, but right now there's a bit of a problem because we're not getting very many canola seeds in, and it's still using up all the canola seeds to make more crystallized canola seeds because this drawer still is not full. But what I'm actually going to do is I'm just going to set this to -1 priority so that this stuff up here gets more priority. And so theoretically, seeds should go in here first. And now that it has done that, it's going to turn into empowered seeds. And now that we're doing that demonstration, I'm actually going to set this back to 0 so this starts getting more seeds again. Okay, and then we are going to set this to in-out mode now, and on the extract, we are going to filter that to only extract these empowered seeds. So let's plop that in there, and we are also going to extract on the blue channel. And then we can come back down here and put down another drawer, and we can set this to only insert on that blue channel. So now, because everything is hooked up to essentially the same, like, really ugly conduit, whenever there is an empowered seed up on that stand, it should get extracted straight into this drawer. Of course, it's not going to do it very often because this dropper is hogging up all the seeds. So now all that's left to do is to set up the crystallized oil into empowered oil setup, which is going to be exactly the same. You guys have seen this before. Okey-dokey. So this side is set up now. The crystallized oil to empowered oil, and it's set up exactly the same way. So the only thing left to do is actually hook up the laser relays to connect these. So we'll put down a fluid laser relay, and we may as well put it here. And then we'll just hook up a fluid conduit right into that. We'll set this to extract and whatnot. And then because this is going to be behind a wall, I'm just going to hook up the other fluid laser relay just like that. So let's just connect those up. And I forgot to put this block in front of this piston, so it just started pulsing whenever I didn't want it to. Awesome. And also, I never set these to pulse mode, which is gonna have something to do with that. Oh, and great. Now we have 53 buckets worth of stuff in this. Oh, no. Alright, problem solved. I just put it into this drum and I'm gonna use that as sort of a buffer. But not before I ran into like 10 gajillion more problems. I had to run this massive cable like so roundabout in this weird way to get it to go into a place that didn't mess up the redstone. And then when doing that, I ran into the water like 8,000 times. Oh, actually, yeah, this stuff is still broken back here. Now it should, everything should work. Everything's so ugly now, but it should work. We really gotta make some facades, because this is just pathetically hideous. It did already make one bucket of empowered oil, which is nice, but we're not getting enough canola seeds in to actually continuously supply this thing with empowered canola seeds. Like, this is still not full. So I think we need to go ahead and expand this canola farm a bit here. I think I want to fill up all of the grass spots I possibly can with canola. And I actually expanded out this little canola farm a little bit, a couple blocks in either direction here, so we could fit in a bit more canola. But I was thinking, we actually have a problem with our current setup. If we're gonna use progressive automation still, we're gonna have to add like 100 more upgrades. And so that's gonna take like 600 iron. I don't even think I have that much iron. And we have to use iron because the iron planter is the lowest tier of planter that can actually keep up with like this size of a farm. And so it seems kind of silly to use literally all of our iron on this one canola farm. So instead of doing that, we're actually going to make an Ender.io farming station. But to get a farming station, we are going to need a slice and splice. And I'm going to put this into the wall because it does take a bit of RF. Now the slice and splice just allows us to create different items to use in crafting recipes, but you do have to supply it with some sort of axe and some sort of shears for it to work. So we need the slice and splice to make a Z-Logic controller, which is made a bit like that, and that's going to do its thing. And every time a crafting recipe completes, these axe and shear are going to take a bit of durability. But anyways, we now have our Z-Logic controller, so we should be able to make a farming station. That is, once we make a couple of pulsating crystals. Now we can make a farming station. And that also means we can go ahead and just destroy this planter. So let's instead place down this farming station, and I sort of marked out the middle block. And the setup for this is going to be pretty similar to what we had before, so we will set down this power cell here. But we are going to have to set up the item extraction a bit differently, so we're going to set this on in-out mode, and we're going to insert on the green and extract on the brown, and we'll set that to always active. And that's pretty much it. The Ender.io farmer is pretty smart, so it'll know to not extract hose and only to really extract the items like canola. So if we set this to insert on the brown, that'll only get the canola and canola seeds that come out of here. And now we need to get some hose into this farming station, but instead of using this big long cable I have running to the farming station, I think we should use our little modular storage setup we did. So I'm just gonna set up another modular storage in here. So I'll place that down, and that's set up to the same link ID as our canola seeds. And then just like before, we're gonna set down an ESD, and we'll set the outbound side to upward, and we'll set the slot numbers as 1 to 0. And those are free slots because we're using 1 and 2 for canola, so that should work out just fine. And then instead of putting the exporter right on the farming station, we're just going to put it right on the ESD. Then once we whitelist hose and we also put in a crafting upgrade, this ESD should hopefully have put a hoe in there, which it did. And so now this ESD will always be supplied with a stone hoe, and it'll craft one if it needs to. So then all we have to do is come back to our farming station and set down a modular storage here. And we'll set this to extract on the green channel. And I'm actually gonna go ahead and filter this extraction, even though it's completely not necessary, I don't believe, because the only thing that the green channel can actually insert is hose, so I don't think it would actually take anything else out. But it gives me peace of mind. So now that there's a hoe in there, I think it's gonna start doing stuff. Yeah, actually. So by default, this farming station is just gonna do its thing in a 7x7 area, so it tilled the land and stuff. Maybe not exactly what we wanted, but let's go ahead and set down our other item laser relay so we can get this item transport back up and running. And I'm actually going to set this farming station to active with signal for now so it doesn't keep planting stuff where I don't want it, because I only want to plant canola on this fertilized dirt. I don't want to plant it on regular dirt. That's pretty lame. And now all the regular dirt is replaced with fertilized dirt. So if we turn this back on to always active, we can start giving this some seeds and we can lock this all in. And of course, just like with the progressive automation machines, we're going to need to actually till all this land before the farming station knows that it can plant stuff on here. And by default, the 7x7 farming station range is not going to be able to reach all of this area, of course. So we're gonna have to equip it with a double layer capacitor. And whenever we put this in, it'll allow it to store a bit more energy, and it'll also increase the range to an 11 by 11. So that's definitely pretty nice. The problem is that we have a bunch of spots, I guess, where it's trying to plant stuff. Yeah, like right here. So we gotta make sure to fill in all of these so it doesn't keep trying to plant things there. Stop it. But now that that is in there, all this area is covered and we're gonna be able to farm all of that, which is awesome. The only thing left to do is to replace our growing standing stones. I'm gonna try and place these in a way that allows it to reach all of the crops. Hopefully I can actually do that. And I actually was able to do it in a way that all these standing stones reach all the crops. It was actually a really nice sort of area for that. So we did more than double the amount of canola crops we had growing here, so hopefully that should double our canola seed output. But we have to wait for all those to fill up before this will start making empowered seeds. But while we're waiting, I think it's about time that we actually pretty up this place, because I'm tired of this looking so ugly. And just a few facades makes everything so much better. We got everything looking nice. Of course, we still got the conduits running everywhere, super ugly. But as long as we can't see it, it's fine. And everything should be completely set up now, I believe. So as soon as we get enough seeds to actually start consistently making these empowered canola seeds, we'll get a bunch more oil going. We only have 2 buckets of empowered oil so far, but... Oh, and actually, I didn't set this to in-out mode, so that would have probably made a difference on the whole empowered seed thing. But now that it is making empowered seeds, we should be making empowered oil now. Yep, you can see it going. But actually, these crops are not sped up as fast as they can be. We can also make some greenhouse glass and put it up there, which I think I am going to do now. So I just made another empowerer, which I didn't want to do in the first place, but I guess I have to now. I will just place that down and set this up as per usual. Now we do need prismarine to make this greenhouse glass, but Britannia actually got rid of the prismarine recipe with the alchemy catalyst, but we can use actually additions instead. So I'm gonna go ahead and place hoppers on top of all of these display stands and whatnot. And then in one of them, I'll place the cyan dye, and in the others, I will evenly split up these prismarine shards, and we're gonna make 13 blocks of empowered palace. So now that one of those is done, we can go ahead and set up a little extraction thing here. So we'll just set this to extract, and then we'll filter empowered palace, and then this will work completely automatically. But actually, we're probably gonna have to take this a bit slowly because my power is rapidly draining. We only have about 1 million RF left. So yeah, we need to let that build up a little bit more, but I do have a little bit of palace now. So I guess it's gonna be a slow process to get all the palace there, but we'll get there eventually. And I got all the greenhouse glass and whatnot that I needed. I hope this is actually the right size. Hopefully I placed this correctly. Yeah, I think I did. So now that that's all greenhouse glassed up, this should hopefully be working pretty quick now. So now the last thing to do is to just hook up this last fluid laser relay over to our generators over there. So let's just hook up a conduit real quick. And then back behind our canola setup, instead of extracting from this drum with the regular oil, we're just going to set down our fluid laser relay right there. And I'm pretty sure this would be out of range, yep. So now if we hook this up, he should start getting empowered oil once they run out of regular oil, hopefully. And yep, it looks like that's exactly what is happening. So once this gets done with this last little bit, we're now getting 200 RF per tick, which is pretty insane. We do have a bit of a problem though, and that's that our energy conduits, I don't believe, can actually handle this. They can only handle 640 RF per tick, and right now we have 6 times 200, which is 1200 RF per tick. So we will upgrade this to enhanced energy conduit, and so then we can transfer 5000 RF per tick, which is plenty. And there we go, that should allow these to start draining, yep, because this conduit can now handle all that RF. And after a bit of a malfunction there, I think everything is now working. Whenever I placed down those fluid laser relays, it really messed everything up because a bunch of conduits were actually connecting to each other. So like there was a conduit here that was connecting. You can see there's still oil in here from whenever I accidentally had these conduits still connected, and then yeah. So essentially the wrong type of oil got put into the fluid collector and placer. It was a big mess. A bunch of seeds got spewed everywhere, but now I think everything's working. That was just a good old goof for me right there. And because we are bottlenecked by the amount of canola seeds we have, I do actually have a way of helping that a little bit at least. So we are going to make a mechanical crafter from extra utilities, and this thing is going to allow us to just do basic crafting recipes. So we will set this down, I guess we'll just set it down here, it doesn't really matter. And then we are going to go ahead and set this to insert, but we're going to set the priority to -1. And so that means this crafter will get filled only after all these canola presses are completely full. And you can see that getting filled now, actually. So if we grab a piece of this canola, we can actually set a crafting recipe. If we just place a piece of canola, that will get turned into canola seeds. We want to set this to in-out mode now, brown channel, and we're only going to extract canola seeds. So if we set this to input on the brown channel, that means whatever canola seeds are extracted from here will go back into the drawer controller. So these seeds will get extracted just like that. And then they'll go into this drawer, which then get fed into our empower and whatnot. So because we have such an excess of canola, we can use that to create canola seeds, which we're bottlenecked by. And I actually thought better of it, and I decided to put an ESD here, which would then feed into the mechanical crafter. And that's just to make it so there's only one stack of canola in here at any given time. That's because this crafter was actually getting completely full of regular canola, and so then it didn't have any space in its inventory to put the canola seeds that it was crafting, so that didn't really work out very well. So if I have the ESD there, there's only one stack and there's always room for these canola seeds. And I have the same setup. This is on priority -1, so this will get filled up last after these canola presses. But I think that is where I'm gonna have to leave you all for this episode. We got quite a bit done and our little oil setup is working very, very nicely. We got a bunch of RF and we can expand this in the future. So I just want to thank you guys so much for watching my videos. If you made it this far, you guys are champions, and I will see you all next time. Goodbye.
It's the pitter-patter of raindrops on this steel hut. Reminds me of old doom drums. We should remove the ceiling before the moon comes. Bobby Brown mirror dance. Convinced your soul hopefully works. Feeling like an errand boy sent by grocery clerks. It's the pitter-patter of raindrops on this steel hut. Reminds me of little hands gripping heirloom tomatoes.